Welcome, everybody. I am Dr. Dian Ginsberg. I am a medical doctor, board certified in obstetrics and gynecology, and I'm also board certified in anti-aging and regenerative medicine. I've been in the young plasma space for approximately the last 5 years, working on clinical applications as well as what we're seeing with different types of processes with young plasma and where it's moving in the research community. I would like to bring you today both research and clinical applications for what we've seen, what we're seeing, and truly how this young plasma or plasma from young donors ages 18 to 24 is affecting not only clinical symptoms, but affecting the epigenetic clock. I thought this was an appropriate slide to say that maybe we can't turn back the clock completely, but we want to be able to apply something to wind it back up again and keep us as healthy as possible. Okay, so what is epigenetic aging? So we know it's associated in some way with DNA methylation, and we have come to speak in this community as estimating age, looking at epigenetic clocks, calling it your DNA methylation age. Now, while we know all tissues do in fact age differently and we realize that, we want to find something that is going to reflect a big picture, say, of our epigenetic methylation age, that we can use a single tissue that's available, that we can run through the lab, that we can truly get data from. And while we know all tissues do age differently, we know that a majority of these epigenetic estimators do use DNA data from a single tissue type as blood. And what you're going to see as we get into this talk a little bit more, that blood really has a big effect on all the surrounding tissues. So not only can we use it as a biomarker of aging, but it really makes a difference in what the tissues that it flows through see and how they act. So just a couple baseline studies before we get into the clinical data. So when we look at changes in the human plasma over a lifetime, there are big keys of changes or waves of changes. And you can see 34, 60, 78. So there are periods in our lifetime, we know that we're going to see major changes in the plasma proteins of blood. And how these are going to affect our tissues are pretty much a lot of the basis of where using young plasma transfusions comes from, because we are trying to take this aging proteome and how it affects the tissues and create a reversal or a rejuvenation, if you would. So the tissue that can't perform like it used to because it doesn't have the stuff it needed or it can't make it anymore, will now be able to grasp on what's delivered from the young plasma and use it to function more efficiently. In that case, we're going to slow, reverse, who knows with aging, but also affect disease state. So why blood? Why do we think blood makes a difference? So here's a paper that talked about stem cell transplants. And what they did is they looked at donor recipient pairs with bigger than 10 years of age difference. And what they found is that the methylation age of the recipients actually matched the chronological age of the donor, even 17 years after the transfusion. So they looked at younger donors that got older blood, and they looked at older that got younger, and it didn't matter which it was. What it shows is that the DNA age or the methylation age of donor blood is not necessarily influenced by the recipients of the environment of the recipient's body. And that basically the DNA methylation age of the blood cells continue to increase after transfer to the recipient's body. So what this is saying is that the donor cells themselves brought them into the recipient's body, and that's what took over. So that is what's making a big difference. The young stuff made the recipient younger and the old stuff made them a little bit older. So the actual blood that you're transfusing in is going to make a very big difference in the recipient's body. It appears, and this is straight also out of PubMed, that the blood system have their own epigenetic aging phase. So they are placed into a recipient and they're not affected. But it's actually the effect that that blood has on the recipient that is significant. So again, the blood cells have an influence on the epigenetic aging of non-blood cells. So you flow it through that other system, and that other system is going to pick up more of what it received from the blood itself. Now, a lot of conversations have been had that supposedly you have to remove old cells. And there's a lot of future research we're doing on how much do you remove? Do you have to remove old cells? What will young plasma do if you put it into the older body or the sicker body? Will it actually create a change in that system where the system can rejuvenate itself? So one of the big criticisms from exchange reactions or exchange transfusions are that you do not see young neurons formed. So that has been a criticism when young plasma is given. So the exchange transfusions will form young neurons. You do not see that as much when the young plasma is infused. However, synaptic plasticity is the ability of the synapses to strengthen or weaken over time. So we may not be seeing large amounts of actual new neurons forming, but the actual changes, if you would, in the older neuron is upregulated. So you are regenerating the neuron itself. So I don't know that you have to grow new neurons if you can actually take these proteins and upregulate them. So ERG1 is transcription and memory formation, and CFOS expression is a marker for neuronal activity and depression, mood. And then cyclic AMP response in this Krebs binding protein will help you make memories. All of those in heterochronic parabiosis where young plasma was added, you saw an increase in that. So again, exchange transfusions with albumin or saline, one of the issues are, they show better growth of young neurons. I just don't know that you need that. Young plasma is going to fix what's already there. Weiss Correa and his group published in March, they did a heterochronic parabiosis, and they found a lot of different changes, positive in what I look at is all the stuff that the plasma really touches. So the more the plasma flowed through that tissue, the better restoration you see. So aging, right, is going to be immune cell dysfunction and accumulation. And that's going to get in front of us and make us sick. Well, when they looked at their heterochronic parabiosis, meaning the addition of the young cells, they saw that 1,000 stem cells were altered by this young blood, changing them, rejuvenating that immune system. And just as, or even more important, they saw a significant improvement in mitochondrial function. So these novel pathways of our function that tend to get less working as we get older are rejuvenated, especially again, mitochondrial pathways when young plasma factors pass through them. So again, the more the plasma touches that tissue, the bigger change they saw in the different parts of the body. So a lot of people are saying, all we need to do is clean out the old and do 3-liter or big exchanges with albumin or saline mixture, or maybe adding a couple factors in there. So here's the questions that I will pose for you. Is it just taking the pressure off the system? Will the body make all the young factors again? And one of the big issues of aging is fading or dysfunctional microbiome. So percentage of optimal microbiome balance, which makes optimal factors that need to accumulate in the body, pass into the tissues, especially the brain, to keep inflammatory reactions from getting out of control, are made by a young microbiome. It is a fact that microbiome diversity decreases with aging, and any microbiologist will tell you that. So if you just take out senescent cells and you don't add young factors and maybe young microbiome products or something that is going to stimulate the microbiome to rebalance again, are you going to get significant effects? And then the other thing that really is never discussed is the implications of a massive exchange. Everybody talks about the issues with plasma and the negative things that happen, but when you really dig down to the big picture here, the FFP-related reactions, when exchange was looked at with FFP, even the severe reactions, nothing's fatal, and theoretically, a severe reaction could be severe itching. Somebody could say, yeah, with that, I got horrible itching, or I got severe hives. That's Benadryl treated. It's not a major complication. So again, you can call it severe, but yet the severity of what it is pretty significant. And I thought what was really key about this, when just exchange reactions were looked at, higher level exchanges, vasovagal access, vascular access. What are you going to do? Can you use a peripheral line? Do you have to use a central line? That's what really becomes significant when you start talking about major exchange transfusions. Okay, so what are we looking at when we're looking at data? Here is the FDA safety data of plasma. In 2019, there was basically just over 2 million transfusions and one avoidable plasma-related fatality, which was trolley. And as long as you minimize your immune interaction, you're not going to have a problem. And we test all females, or spectrum plasma tests all females, for HLA. So as long as your HLA tested, your system is safe. In 2020, there were actually no plasma-related fatalities. I did 25 years of OB-GYN, and I saw a lot of plasma hung in a lot of postpartum hemorrhages, and patients did very well. And we used to push that plasma in as aggressively as you can imagine when somebody had a postpartum hemorrhage. So in looking at the AMBAR study data, right, what I want you to look at is look at the significant dropouts. You'll see here who started, how many people started, and 347 people randomized. But you can just look at the dropouts, and only 232 finished. And I think what's really significant when you read deep into the study is that they're talking about 20% of people had issues with central access. Again, that is a central line. There's all kinds of things that have to be considered when you can't get peripheral access. And especially as you're looking as people get older, vascularity gets thinner, the ability to pump and run that fluid at that volume through delicate blood vessels is very difficult. Whereas when you're looking at just an easier straight IV infusion of young plasma, or even what I'm going to talk about, a mini exchange where you're just taking a little bit out, 1 liter out, putting 1 liter in, and you're going to get a lot of positive effects from that. You can do that more frequently. You can do it more as an outpatient, and you really don't have to worry about these major complications. Here's just a couple interesting studies on what young plasma, young blood plasma did to all different parts of the body. So here they showed a significant increase in proliferation capacities and a decrease of senescent cells in cardiac stem cells. So not only did they see an upregulation, so when they did an open heart and they took a biopsy from the heart, they took a little piece of the heart, and then they put it in a dish and they isolated the stem cells, what they found when they have exposed the stem cells to young plasma, they found a significant increase of proliferation, but they also found a decrease in senescent cells. So the question that starts to come up is, if you truly give the right amount of plasma in the right balance, which is something we're going to find out, I think, sooner rather than later. Once a week, use a little bit every other week. Once you find out what you need to do to rejuvenate the system, do you even need to do a removal? Because the system will actually rejuvenate itself, just like a young system does, right? Young people in their 20s, they pull their senescent cells out. They don't need to worry about that as much. This is a comment from Michael Fossil. It's a quote from Michael Fossil, who's a massive MD telomere researcher, and talks about aging being a cascade of changes. And I thought this was great. He says the Alzheimer's, okay, so your neurons die, the beta amyloid accumulates in the mitochondria, so you have a problem. Well, why did that happen? Well, because the microglial cells changed. But why did the microglial cells change their behavior? Because the cell divided. So cell divides, telomere shortens, system becomes less efficient, tissues can't do what it needs to do anymore, senescent cells can't be cleared, sleep's not as deep, beta amyloid doesn't clear, and boom, Alzheimer's develops. So you can stay downstream and you can keep trying to pick up the pieces, or you can go above and say, wait a minute, if I put better stuff back in here, all of a sudden the brain doesn't realize those cells divide. It goes, oh, maybe I can function better. Same thing we do when I replace with hormones. When you elevate estrogen levels, you drop inflammation, because now the cells look around and go, oh, the microbiome maybe will be happy. Now there's more estrogen. Maybe I can have a baby. So the cells change their behavior. In doing that, you may not need to remove senescent cells, because you may see such an improvement in cellular function. Now, how does young plasma make a difference? Because this is what it gives you. We know and have seen in research what exosomes are doing. Well, when you use just 20 cc's of young plasma, you're getting 34 billion exosomes. And if you're getting one 200 cc unit, you're getting 374. You put a liter in, multiply that times five. The exosome volume's huge. Here's, to me, the big key, though. Exosomes, right, are modulators. We know that from the literature. A exosome tells B tissue what to do. But if the tissue doesn't have the antioxidant capability, the microbiome byproducts, the hormones and the metabolites it needs, all of the growth factors in the brain, the brain growth factors, if the tissues haven't made that, then the exosome modulation will be less efficient. Yeah, maybe it can kick an old dog, kick an old tissue to make it do what it needs to do. But if you float the exosomes with young factors, what you're going to find is a significantly improved overall functionality. Okay, brand new paper, August 2022, where they took young plasma and looked at the gut microbiome. And they looked at middle-aged rats. And what we know is that with aging, the Firmicutes Bacteroides ratio increases, right? So we live on this planet, we move along, we have our cost of doing business, right? Sunlight, food, all those good things we need to live, elevate our cost of doing business. As that starts to happen, the Firmicutes Bacteroides ratio changes, increases, and we get more dysbiosis. So the microbiome changes. And we know when we look relative to non-neurotoxic patients, Alzheimer's and other neurotoxic problems, we know that they have a higher Firmicutes Bacteroides ratio. So Parkinson's, MS, all of that, there's tons of research on gut dysregulation. So in this study, there was a significant improvement in the Firmicutes Bacteroides ratio. It changed. It moved closer to a youthful microbiome, which hugely significant in healing the overall body. So what did we see clinically when we used young fresh frozen plasma? Now, when we initially started to use the plasma, it was a variety of what we did. Somebody might have gotten an exchange and then decided to get a couple liters of plasma. Somebody might have said, I just want the plasma straight. We're now involved, and I'm going to talk to you guys about a study we're going to look at to find what is the most effective way to infuse it or overall manage each patient. Stanford chose to do 200 cc's a week over 8 weeks. Other people decide to hang a liter at a time for patient convenience. What we found, most of these patients received 1 or 2 liters, usually separated by a couple days, but they got a full liter at a time. But you can see the clinical improvement. Sleep got better. Sense of well-being felt better. The Graves' ophthalmic disease got better. Blood glucose, diabetes numbers significantly went down. And I have a clinical study to show you of that. Spine and back pain. And it's not just, oh, I had some pain. I mean, these were people that said, I just couldn't get better. They'd seen orthopedics. They'd seen neurosurgeons. They'd seen chiropractors. They've done everything they could. And the pain just didn't go away. Chronic muscle pain, erectile dysfunction with aging, significant documented eyesight, clinical improvements across the board. Recently, James Clement did a human study using umbilical cord plasma concentrate. So they used small amounts of plasma from umbilical cords in, I think, 100 cc IM injections and did an intramuscular injection on 18 people for 10 weeks. And they found GrimAge improvement, significant GrimAge improvement. And interesting here, they found 0.82 years. I'll show you in some of our clinical studies that we've done here that we've seen a GrimAge improvement of 4 to 5 years. Now, again, how long, how much repeated do you have to do it? That's what we're going to find out over time. But we're seeing big changes here when plasma is added. What's really cool about this study is that it's a human study that's done. Okay, this was our study that we did in the Texas Medical Center on Parkinson's patients. So we found 22 to meet our inclusion criteria, 3 withdrew for personal reasons. We actually had 19 randomized, 2 had itching, and they just were uncomfortable. They got maybe a quarter, a little bit more in, and into the transfusion, and they got, or infusion, and they got a little anxious and they didn't want to continue. So we wound up randomizing 7 that actually got plasma and 10 that got placebo. And what we did here was that the placebo had a little B6 in it. So the both bags, even though they were covered, were yellow. So you couldn't tell what you were getting. We did baseline. We did 1 month, 3 month, and 6 month on UPDRS score and Stanford presenteeism scale, which I think is really cool because even though it's not traditionally used with Parkinson's, it represents how you feel about yourself and your job. One of the biggest issues with Parkinson's, it's not just the shaking and the motor, it's where your brain is. It's the apathy, it's the depression. Neurologists talk about that all the time that come along with it. So the fact that there was a statistically significant improvement in the way people felt at 6 months after their infusion, to me is key in quality of life. And none of these patients went off their meds. They were all treated exactly the same. The only difference is one group got 2 liters of plasma and one group got 2 liters of B6. When we summed up the UPDRS scale, we found a statistically significant improvement in overall across the board in the patients that got the young plasma. And they did very, very, very well. Okay, so now we get deeper into epigenetics, actual changes that we're seeing as we've started to use true diagnostic testing to see how everything is affected. So what we took initially, and I've got some case studies for you here. Here's a 71-year-old who's a type 2 diabetic, and his hemoglobin A1C was 8.5, his glycosylated hemoglobin. And his medical history is really significant, probably across the board, for just apathy. You know, autoimmune, gut's not great, eyesight isn't good. And on top of just the A1C being a problem and the diabetes being a problem, he didn't talk to anybody on the phone, really didn't talk to his family, didn't interact with his wife, kind of just sat at home. He received 2 liters of plasma, one day of plasma, 2 days apart, another liter, no removal of anything. And within a month, his eyesight got better. Everybody around him noticed he was better. Physical activity, motivation, two huge things. The autoimmune rash went away, which makes sense because his microbiome probably got better from the plasma. But look at his hemoglobin A1C. We saw the drop at 1 month, and understanding that, yes, there can be a lab error, but his 2 month A1C, no change in meds, no change in diet, is down to 7. And what is the talk of obesity and diabetes and the effect it's going to have on the aging people and on the economy and on the medical system? And you get a combination here because you get a drop in the A1C, but then you feel better. Same thing we see with Parkinson's. People get sick because when their brain doesn't work and they don't feel good, they don't want to take a walk, they don't want to get the sunshine, they can't get their circadian rhythms in line, everything becomes an issue. When you put back a healthier microbiome and the system lines back up again and the blood sugar comes down and the brain is better, people want to live again. Here was his true diagnostic test. Now, we didn't see any major change yet. And one of the things that we think also goes on is that there's a hormesis reaction. And we're going to see that in another patient that I'm going to talk about that we actually have more data on. But like anything else, and this has been reported in the literature, that hormesis occurs with the infusion. And we know this, right? Because we know that when we sit with the ice bath or we do running intervals or we do anything, we do cold therapy or warm therapy or sauna, anything that we do, we know puts our body through that mild stress. So we're going to get a change here. But if you notice, it started to all come down again. Now, I'll have a follow-up for you at his 3 and 4 months where we see that everything went down, because on this particular patient, we only got 2 months. I'll show you the next patient. We saw a significant drop. Now, again, what also happens is you have to look at how sick somebody is. So somebody maybe that has more medical issues or more methylation issues, it's going to take longer to reverse. What was fascinating with this patient is his pace of aging slowed significantly. So you take a 71-year-old who's sick. Now you're watching his hemoglobin A1C come down and his pace of aging slow. He gets the hormesis reaction. So I'll show you where we are in the next couple of months, but I'll bet you're going to see his GrimAge come down, his PhenoAge come down as he starts to feel better and get healthy. Okay, now here's what we really are leaning towards looking at too, something we call a mini-me. One of the issues that I talked about is this huge concept of having to do a big 3-liter exchange, which is expensive. And again, central line, hard on the body as you get older. Whereas if we know and we're seeing some senescent cell removal with rejuvenation of the tissues, then do we have to do anything or do we do a little out, a little in? So we do what we call a mini-me. It's peripheral line. It's simple 1 liter out while you exchange 1 liter of FFP in. And we know it's safe because blood banks all over country and the world, I guess, are doing plasma donations and they'll let you go in twice a week. Right? You go in, a lot of people get paid for their plasma. You sit down, you give them the 600 cc's and you leave and they'll take you back 3 days later. So here we're going to take a liter out, put a liter in, and we're keeping even better fluid balance. Now, what are the couple patients that we looked at? I wanted to give you kind of a variety, a little younger patient and an older patient. Now, this 56-year-old male did receive a total plasma exchange, the 3 liter 2 weeks prior to his FFP mini exchange. Unfortunately, the doc that did this did not do any baseline testing. And I tried to reach out and get it, and I can't. So if anything was done, we don't have access to it. But I made sure that we did a baseline before we did our mini exchange. So, and we followed him 4 to 5 months out. So we know where we're starting anything that's been created over the 2 weeks, or any hormesis reaction has been recorded over the 2 weeks. And now we're just going to look where we go from what we've added. So he said after his single, one out, one in that we did, that dry mouth is gone and he's feeling better. Weight fell off and ejaculation better, or less issues in the bedroom, if you would. But his overall sense of well-being in every way is much better. And the weight loss was no effort. Basically just came off without a problem. Here's his true age. So we've got his 1 month, or his baseline, his 1 month, and his 5 months. So this is prior to the mini me, after his 3 liter exchange. And you can see that his GrimAge just continued to go down. What's really interesting, and not is 2.16 years, is look at what his pace of aging was. His pace of aging slowed 31%. I mean, it's pretty impressive across the board here. And he continues to feel well. The key, I think, is that we're going to see over time again is, does the young plasma also affect people differently depending on your age? So if you're older, are you going to need more? Are you going to need more frequent to start? Are you going to get a bigger or a slower hormesis? So in this case, we've got somebody who's 54 and notices a dramatic difference pretty quickly. We did the same mini-me exchange in a 70-year-old, and we saw interesting changes. We just saw more of a return to baseline quicker. So same thing here, 1 liter removal, 1 liter replacement. Skin color, energy improved, overall sense of well-being, 10 pounds within 2 weeks came off without an issue. And here I've got a bunch of tests to show you. So we did 2 weeks, 4 weeks, 12 weeks. 2 weeks, 4 weeks, 12 weeks out. So here's significant in a 70-year-old. Look at the huge drop. So he's older with his initial GrimAge. He gets the hormesis reaction and then goes down significantly. A 5-year reversal in GrimAge. Now, at 4 months, it started to creep back up again. What I thought was interesting is that his PhenoAge stayed the same. So again, is it some of the markers? Is it a bunch of things that we've kind of got to look at? Why did the PhenoAge stay the same with what they look at? The GrimAge started to get worse again. And here again, do you then just have to infuse this person with another liter? Do you infuse them with just another 200 cc's? You see a dramatic reaction and then you notice it bumps back up again. Maybe you continue it going. Which brings me to same thing here. We didn't see a decrease in Dunedin pace, which is interesting because the GrimAge got significantly better here, even though the pace of aging didn't decrease. Now, again, everything measures slightly different parameters. So why did we see his PhenoAge and his GrimAge get better, but no in pace of aging? Medical issues. Do we need to give this person more? Will we see next time the Dunedin pace drop? Because he's older, are we going to have to give a little more? What is this person's diet? What are their testosterone estrogen levels? How do we add this therapy to looking at somebody's microbiome? So I think the big picture that brings home is that we're seeing a lot of changes. We just don't know what perfection is, and it may be bioindividuality with everybody, which is what brings me to the end of my talk and the study that's going to be going on now. So what we want to know is if we give 2 liters within 30 days, however we give it, what changes are we going to see? We've got 14 co-investigators so far, and what it's going to be is a 2 liter exchange, a 2 liter straight hang. You can do a mini me, one in, one out. You can do a 3-liter exchange with the 2 liters at the same time. What is going to be optimal? We're going to look at brain check, which is a cognitive test on the computer to see how that changes. We're going to look at the epigenetic methylation. So we're going to do a true diagnostic test on everybody. And then we're going to do some practical parameters, frailty test, grip strength, rising from a chair, some basic parameters to see how everything's affected. So this study will sort of be ongoing. As many people as we can start to accumulate and make the information available, so we'll be able to see what is the best way to go and start to maybe find trends, and then eventually move to a level and say, hey, if you've got Parkinson's in your family or Alzheimer's in your family, we found with these people, with this history, this is what reversed it. So I think this is just really an amazing opportunity to use a well-studied, years and years and years and years, plasma has been used for saving lives for forever, to turn around and really change the way medicine is practiced and work on longevity and really help the aging and the sick populations.